Hey, welcome everybody. We're about to get started. Welcome to another night of College of Complexes. We meet here at every Saturday from 6 p.m. until 9 p.m. at 2901 West Anniston. We have a couple of simple rules and a simple agenda. We have two rules. One rule is one fool at a time. Second rule is no personal attacks. We don't like that one, do we? And the agenda is real simple. We have announcements, then we have the speaker, then we have Q&A time. During Q&A time, we ask you to ask a question and not make a statement. Statements or remarks are reserved for the last thing, which is our remarks time. We usually have up to about 5 minutes for a remark. And at the very end, the presenter gets the last word, okay?
So, let's see. Mr. Aranda, are you ready? All right, then. Ted Aranda. I'm glad you all made it in this weather. I was a little bit worried. And I'm sorry if I didn't greet some of you all that nicely when I walked in, because I'm kind of discombobulated. I can't even say the word. Because this has been quite a lot of work. Okay. So, without further ado, this study of mine of Robert F. Kennedy's assassination is part of a larger job that I'm doing, a larger piece of research. And I'm calling it Empire of Deception, Cold War, JFK, RFK, 9/11, and War on Terror. Okay, so this study is a wide view examination of how the American ruling class has kept us, the American people, under their thumb for some 70 years through the vast use of deceptive violence. Can everybody see that okay?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's right. Okay. This RFK section of the larger study is a short history of the Robert F. Kennedy presidential campaign and the candidate's assassination. Now, as you all know, 1968 was an election year, and the major issue in that year was the Vietnam War. Author David Halberstam says, "The war. Nothing dominated American life in 1967 and 1968 like the war. It flashed across the television sets each night. And I myself remember the tallies, you know, the numbers of dead, of Viet Cong, Americans, whatever. I remember that when I was 6, 7, 8 years old. It sapped the financial resources of the country, and more, it sapped its moral fiber. In a country consumed by serious social problems, everything eventually led back to the war. Nothing could be done until the war was over. LBJ was busy escalating the war, intent on winning it. So, mainly on the basis of opposition to the Vietnam War, Robert F. Kennedy, U.S. Senator from New York, brother of former President John F. Kennedy, and the former President's Attorney General, decided to enter the race for the presidency." That's him announcing there. And 2 days after he announced, the first thing that he did was give this speech in Kansas. It was at Kansas State University on March 18th. And I'll read a few paragraphs from that speech, because it's really quite a speech, quite remarkable. Something that, the kind of thing that you wouldn't hear an American president say in the past many decades. "Today, I would speak to you of the war in Vietnam. I am concerned, as I believe most Americans are concerned, the course we are following at the present time is deeply wrong. I am concerned, as I believe most Americans are concerned, that we are acting as if no other nations existed, against the judgment and desires of neutrals and our historic allies alike. I am concerned, as I believe most Americans are concerned, that our present course will not bring victory, will not bring peace, will not stop the bloodshed, and will not advance the interests of the United States or the cause of peace in the world. I'm concerned that at the end of it all, there will be only more Americans killed, more of our treasure spilled out, and because of the bitterness and hatred on every side of this war, more hundreds of thousands of Vietnamese slaughtered, so that they may say of us, as Tacitus said of Rome, they made a desert and called it peace. And I do not think that this is what the American spirit is really all about. An American commander said of the town of Bentre, it became necessary to destroy the town in order to save it. We must ask our government, we must ask ourselves, where does such logic end? If it becomes necessary to destroy all of South Vietnam in order to save it, will we do that too? And if we care so little about South Vietnam that we are willing to see the land destroyed and its people dead, then why are we there in the first place? Can we ordain to ourselves the awful majesty of God to decide what cities and villages are to be destroyed, who will live and who will die, and who will join the refugees wandering in a desert of our own creation? It is said that we are protecting Thailand, or perhaps Hawaii, from the legions of communists. Are we really protecting the rest of Southeast Asia by this spreading conflict? And in any case, is the destruction of South Vietnam and its people a permissible means of defense? This war must be ended. So, Robert Kennedy was a very formidable candidate. He had many political advantages. He was universally known and widely admired. He was generally viewed as an experienced and competent public official. He had practically been a co-president with JFK. And here are some famous photographs. I know one of these almost everybody has seen. That one right there. Has just about everybody seen that? I hope you have. Uh-uh. Oh, can you? Okay. Has anybody seen this photograph? Uh-uh. Yeah. This is I think during the Cuban Missile Crisis, or one of these humongous crises in the presidency. And these two were always conferring with each other.
Wow. Excuse us, Ted, but your the picture's blocked.
Step aside.
Yeah. Okay. So if you want us to see the thing, you have to move to your right.
Oh, I'm blocking.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I see. Where's Tim? Tim, maybe I should be like here.
Yeah, with that water.
That
water.
That lady is supposed to sit out as well.
No.
Yeah, this is good.
No. Okay. That lady sit out.
Can everybody see? No, you guys can't see.
We're sure.
Am I okay now?
There. Tim. Will you ask her to sit down?
Tim. Can we put this like right here?
Is that possible?
That's maybe fine. Better. Yeah. No, this is a little bit up.
No.
Oh, God.
Okay, whatever.
Maybe you should get hemorrhoids.
We got only enough.
Okay, is everybody okay right now?
Yeah.
Seeing the screen.
Yeah, just sit down. They can't see.
Can you sit down?
Please sit down or get out.
Oh, Charlie.
Come on now.
Leave against the wall.
Every week we've got some issues.
Okay. So, now that's them again, and here at one of their many Senate committee hearings or whatever. Okay, Kennedy had rock star status with the famous Kennedy mystique. Money, of course, was not an issue for him. Being a longtime Kennedy politician, he already had an organization. He had a natural charisma, something that, by contrast, his Democratic rival Eugene McCarthy conspicuously lacked. And he had a well-earned reputation for honesty, toughness, tenacity, and even ruthlessness in fighting the good fight. Author Joseph Palermo says, from the time of President Kennedy's assassination, members of the press recognized his potential to attain the highest office in the land. When he traveled abroad, foreign leaders received him as if he were head of state, not a junior senator. Kind of like a crown prince destined, this is what I'm saying. I think of him as like a crown prince destined to succeed his brother, King John, on the throne. You know, Camelot, there was this royalty
right.
about the Kennedys.
Right.
The tone and style of Kennedy's campaign was tuned to the passions that years of war and civil rights struggles had inflamed. The frenzied throngs that crushed the candidate at campaign stops created a frightening spectacle. Kennedy was a force on the stump, seldom seen in American national politics. Well, that's one more of them together. By the way, Robert Kennedy and Lyndon Johnson, oh my God, if you ever got them in a room alone and both of them had knives, one or both of them wouldn't come out alive. So that's Kennedy on the stump. As soon as Kennedy entered the race for the Democratic nomination, he started winning primaries. When he won California on June 4, everybody could see that he was well on his way to becoming the president. RFK was widely seen as the champion of the people, specifically the spokesman and leader of the poor, the disenfranchised, and the dissatisfied in America. As such, he was seriously dangerous to the establishment, since high-level politicians are supposed to be only rhetorically and superficially concerned with the lower classes, not really. But Robert Kennedy was not that type. He championed, for instance, the cause of migrant workers and supported Cesar Chavez and his farm workers' union. This was a very special occasion. Cesar Chavez was on strike. The whole union was on strike. Oh, he was on a fast, okay? And Kennedy went there to be with him and break bread with him. He spoke up, Kennedy spoke up for the plight of American Indians, something almost unique among major politicians at that time. And he generally got the support of blue-collar whites and urban Catholics. And of course, he was Catholic. And most of all, he was seen as the black candidate, quote unquote. He would visit black areas where hardly any mainstream white politicians would go, and he would be mobbed. Kennedy expressed a strong critique of racism in America at a time of heightened racial tension. Palermo says, Kennedy showed an empathy with blacks' frustrations at a time when the right wings of both major political parties were calling for increased repression under the guise of law and order. Kennedy espoused and sponsored such things as civil rights legislation, massive increases in federal aid for urban jobs, and billion-dollar public works projects. He worked closely with the civil rights movement and with Martin Luther King in an informal alliance. This relationship has been described as a genuine spiritual brotherhood, and Kennedy strongly supported the hopes and objectives of King's Poor People's Campaign. In general, Kennedy was working on building a progressive coalition based on bringing together low-income whites and blacks. Halberstam says, his speeches are terribly simple, and here he's paraphrasing. Decency is the heart of the matter. The death and maiming of young men in the swamps of Asia is indecent. For a man to work with his hands in the valley of California with no hope of sending his son to college, that is also indecent. I think we can do better in America. Historians have called RFK the tribune of the underclass in his day. He was a true populist, something very rare among major politicians in the modern era. And by that I'm talking about after the early 20th century. There were few really real populists. He connected with the common people. He was seen as genuine, the real deal. In the USA of 1968, RFK was literally the embodiment of the nation's hope for progress. So naturally, given that given what Robert Kennedy was about, he was deeply at odds with the establishment. Author Terrence Popp says, the efforts of John and Robert Kennedy represented a commitment to resist a set of economic beliefs that subordinates all social and development considerations to the demands of private capital and the world market. Robert Kennedy would take up the cause where his brother left off, continuing to combat and oppose the Rockefeller, i.e. that is to say the corporate worldview. RFK adopted and extended JFK's presidential agenda, including a resolve to end the Vietnam War. Halberstam continues, dissent by Robert Kennedy on the war was not idle dissent. It was dissent by so powerful a political figure on so important an issue as to represent a frontal challenge to the administration. At my last presentation where I talked about John F. Kennedy, I concentrated on his assassination, and I tried to get into his politics more and his policies, which were really relatively radical. It's really quite a story that hardly anybody knows. I didn't even know it just a little while ago. And unfortunately, I'm not going to be able to get into that very important story today either. But Robert Kennedy was extending the Kennedys' opposition to the corporate status quo. Worst of all for the establishment, Robert F. Kennedy, when he became president, was intent on finally launching a real investigation into his brother's murder, which he already knew was their handiwork. In sum, Robert F. Kennedy had tremendous pull and influence in American politics, and now he was on the doorstep of the presidency. After he won California, everybody knew he was really on the road to become president. He had to be killed. Like the JFK assassination a few years before, and countless other operations of the same type, the assassination of Robert F. Kennedy was a great deception, It happened on the night of June 4 to 5, near midnight June 4, going into early morning of the 5th, just after midnight, specifically 12:15 a.m. This was at the Ambassador Hotel in Los Angeles. Kennedy has just finished his victory speech in the hotel's main ballroom after winning the primary, the California primary. And he's now crossing through a small, cramped kitchen pantry on the way to a press conference in another part of the hotel. How many of you all know the basic parameters of the RFK assassination? Like, have some idea of what happened?
Okay.
So he's passing through this dingy little pantry, okay. The hotel maitre d', Carl Euchre, and that's Carl right there, leads Kennedy along with a small crowd toward the swinging doors leading into the pantry. As he slowly walks through the pantry, while shaking hands with the busboys, which is very symbolic of the kind of man Kennedy was, even though he was rich himself, he didn't have disdain for lower classes. Obviously, that's what I was talking about before. As he's walking through, Kennedy is being pulled by his right wrist by Euchre, like that. Okay. Hotel security guard Thane Caesar is right behind Kennedy, holding his right elbow. Suddenly, a young man in front of Kennedy, namely Sirhan Sirhan, reaches out and starts shooting. After the second shot, Euchre grabs Sirhan's gun hand and directs it away from Kennedy, like that. He's recreating what happened for the sake of this reporter. Actually, that guy is Ted Chirac on the right. He made this film about the Kennedy assassination. Okay. After the second shot, as I said, Euchre grabs Sirhan's gun and directs it away from Kennedy. When the shooting is over, after 5 seconds, Kennedy has been struck 3 times, and 5 others in the entourage have also been hit. Kennedy is the only one fatally wounded. Has anybody seen that famous photograph? I'm really curious. How many people have seen that photograph? Okay. Now, you know, this is really amazing because this should be common known history. Every high school kid should know this. Okay, should have seen images too. You know, you should read this thing and see pictures in the history books on this sort of thing. That's him there. Sirhan is immediately overpowered by a number of men and taken into custody by the police when they arrive. He is found to be a Palestinian, and it is soon decided by the authorities that he acted out of anti-Israeli political motives and that he acted alone. Another low nut, quote-unquote, like Lee Harvey Oswald. Huh. That's him being grabbed and subdued. That's Sirhan. Now, there are a hell of a lot of fatal problems, not to mention unaddressed issues, in the official lone assassin scenario that actually make complete nonsense of it. One, the firing position. It was unequivocally determined in Kennedy's autopsy that the shots that hit him were from point-blank range. The fatal shot was to the head just behind the right ear. 2 shots were to the body, and the fourth went through his suit coat without striking him. They were all from Kennedy's right rear, right behind him. And they were all steeply upward. They were not from Sirhan's position, which was several feet in front of Kennedy, and they were not from a level gun, which was the angle of the gun at the end of Sirhan's outstretched arm. This is where the fatal shot came from. Like that. Now, Sirhan had a short barrel revolver, but this is being used so that you'll see the angles better. But that's where the fatal shot was. This is one of the upward shots into his abdomen, like so. And that's a recreation showing the extreme angles. They might not have been that extreme. Of course, they weren't there. These folks weren't there, so they don't know these things exactly. But that's roughly what we're talking about. Thomas Noguchi, and that's Noguchi in the middle there, the LA coroner and chief medical examiner, and his two assistants performed a meticulous professional autopsy under the observation of three top military pathologists, as well as representatives of the LAPD, the FBI, the Secret Service, and the Sheriff's Office. There we go, there are the shots. The fatal shot to Kennedy's head left a well-defined burn or tattooing effect, as happens only with shots from point-blank range, meaning in the range of about an inch, and no more than, say, 3 inches away. Noguchi said, the nitrite deposits and powder burns on the body, which were deeply embedded, indicated conclusively that the shots were fired from very close range. And Noguchi demonstrated. The many witnesses to the shooting, The many witnesses to the shooting unanimously observed that the gun had been several feet away from Kennedy's head when Sirhan fired, most witnesses placing it about 3 feet away, like so, in this little cartoon recreation. Euchre said, there's no way that the shots described in the autopsy could have come from Sirhan's gun. Sirhan never got close enough for a point-blank shot. Never. Witness Lisa Urso said, the gun was 3 to 6 feet from the senator's head. The first shot was not up against his head because it was next to my head. And remember, this was, well, I didn't explain. There were a lot of people in the little group in this crowded pantry. So there were a lot of people right in the immediate vicinity. Urso further reports that Kennedy immediately grabbed his head his head behind his right ear and jerked forward. Okay, let me read that again. She reports that Kennedy immediately grabbed his head behind his right ear and jerked forward. Okay, without question, the origin of the shots that hit Kennedy was from behind him and slightly to his rear. Again, like that. Another problem, the number of bullets. Okay, these are forensic, scientific, easily verified, if you want to verify, facts. Okay, 7 bullets were recovered from the bodies of Senator Kennedy and the 5 surviving shooting victims. According to authorities, the 8th bullet was lost in the ceiling. So according to the authorities, these are all the shots accounted for hitting Kennedy on the right there, all the folks, other people, and into the ceiling. Okay. Okay, so all the 8 bullets that Sirhan's 22 pistol held are accounted for, and he didn't reload. This is according to the official view. The presence of even one more bullet anywhere or evidence of it proves a second gunman. There were, in fact, more than 8 bullets fired in the pantry. Therefore, there was more than one gunman. Numerous ceiling panels were removed during the investigation that began immediately following the shooting, apparently due to bullets having struck them. Urso, that same woman that I mentioned before, who hung around the crime scene for a few hours, observed 5 or 6 panels on the floor, 2 of which alone had 4 bullet holes in them. LAPD criminologist Dwayne Wolfer is quoted as having said, it's unbelievable how many holes there are in the kitchen ceiling. There's a Sirhan's gun, by the way. And here are some of the panels up there that they're inspecting, and you can see some of them have been removed. Why would they remove panels if there weren't bullet holes in them, right? There you go. And according to the official theory, there was only one bullet in obviously one ceiling panel. Even more damning to the lone, let me see if I got them all, okay. Even more damning to the lone gunman scenario is that there were certainly bullet holes in the pantry door frame, as attested by several reliable witnesses. Okay, there goes some holes there. That's Dr. Noguchi again. Holes down there on the bottom, toward the bottom. Right there. Holes there. Holes in that center post there. Bullet holes, bullet holes, bullet holes everywhere. Okay, FBI veteran William Bailey confirms the presence of bullet holes in the wood. They were bullet holes. I've seen bullet holes in wood before. I looked into these holes. They were definitely not nail holes. There appeared to be objects inside. Later he said, I personally observed in that center divider 2 bullet holes. I looked at them very closely. I did observe what appeared to be the base of a bullet in each hole. LA PD photographer, Charles Collier, who goes around to crime scenes photographing bullet holes. That's what he does, among other things. He says, a bullet hole looks like a bullet hole if you photograph enough of them. And he confirmed that there were bullet holes. Police officers Lamoureux, MacArthur, Rowland, and Beringer all witnessed bullet holes. Sergeant Raymond Rowland said, one of the investigators pointed to a hole in the doorframe and said, we just pulled a bullet out of here. And remember, according to the official theory, there are no bullet holes in any wood in any doorframe. There was just this one in a ceiling panel. Several witnesses say they heard many more than 8 shots. The clinching evidence of more than 8 shots having been fired is a tape recording made at the time, but only noticed much later noticed, by a visiting Polish reporter covering the U.S. presidential race. This recording, the only audio recording made of the shooting, was studied by several experts, including Phil Van Praag, an electrical engineer with 35 years experience in the audio industry, and the author of a textbook on sound recorders. His meticulous analysis revealed 13 sound shots. I cannot absolutely guarantee that 13 is the correct number, he said. However, it is greater than 8. I can certainly say that. Within the 13 shot sounds, there are a couple of instances of what I call double shots. 2 shots that occur so closely together that they couldn't have come from a single weapon. It simply isn't possible to fire a weapon that fast. And the analyses by these experts show a pattern. 2 shots, then a 1.5 second pause, then the rest of the shot in a burst at fraction of a second intervals. And this exactly corresponds with the descriptions of the witnesses at the scene. Another huge problem. Now, each of these problems that I'm listing is insurmountable. If you were doing a real investigation, you wouldn't even have to go into all of this. You could stop at 1 or 2 of them, right? Because any one of these, gives a lie to this nonsense story. Okay, so another issue, in Congress, guns and bullets, things don't match up. To verify that someone has fired a gun and shot a person, you have to reshoot the gun, examine the bullet that comes out of it, and then compare that bullet to the bullet removed from the shooting victim. But to match bullets from Sirhan's gun with those found in the victims, in order to confirm that Sirhan had in fact done all the shooting with his gun, the LAPD tested a gun other than Sirhan's gun. A different gun that they got from who knows where. They could have got it at Kmart. They didn't have Walmart in those days. The gun test fired by the LAPD in its quote-unquote investigation had a different serial number from Sirhan's gun. Oh, there goes another bullet hole. Okay, there's Sirhan's gun, and right there is the serial number. Now, this is from a film with low resolution, but that number is H53725. Okay. Now, here is the test gun, the report on the test gun, and as you can see there in the lower left, that number is different, H18602. They used a different gun to test, quote-unquote, Sirhan's gun. Astoundingly, the LAPD deliberately and admittedly, they said, we're not going to test fire Sirhan's gun, we're going to get some other gun. They left Sirhan's gun in storage. They went and got a gun of the same make and manufacture, okay, which is utterly ridiculous and useless, since all guns, even identical guns, the same manufacturer, leave unique markings on bullets, like fingerprints. Then the LAPD, now get this, the LAPD destroyed the gun that they had used to test quote-unquote Sirhan's gun. Right there, that's the record of it. Later they destroyed it. The LAPD therefore had no bullets fired by Sirhan's gun to compare with the bullets found in the victims to determine if those bullets were actually fired by Sirhan's gun, confirming that Sirhan shot one or more persons on the night of the assassination. They couldn't confirm that, okay. Another discovery by real investigators, investigators, not the authorities, was that the bullets that hit A, Kennedy, and B, one of the 5 other victims, had definitely been fired from 2 different guns. Independent, renowned criminologists William Harper and Herbert McDonald that guy right there, that guy right there, studied the bullet markings, that is the grooves and striations caused by the rifling of the gun barrel on one, a bullet removed from Kennedy's neck, because there was the head wound. That bullet was more or less destroyed. You couldn't make out, you know, what it was all about. And there were a couple other shots, but there was a bullet that they removed from his neck. So they studied that bullet, a bullet removed from one of the five other victims, a man named Weissel, and the bullet fired from the LAPD's test gun, apparently before they destroyed that gun. They found all three bullet markings were definitely different. Now remember, there's only supposed to be one gun in this story, fired a maximum of eight times. Eight bullets, one gun. Okay, already, you know, we've gone way past that limit, right? So there are these striations of this is one of the bullets. They compared three bullets. Okay, those are the three bullets with high precision photography. Okay, there's the Weissel bullet. There's the Kennedy bullet, and there's the test bullet. And now I'm not an expert, but they say, these experts say that it's very obvious that these are different bullets because they have different markings on them. Okay, the bullet markings being different means that the guns used to shoot Kennedy and Weissel were also different. In other words, two guns were fired on the night of the assassination. Another problem, a big problem, impossible trajectories for Sirhan's gun. Several of the bullet trajectories posited by the authorities in their eight bullets only recreation of the crime are impossible, much like the infamous JFK magic bullet. And here is the official set of trajectories which make no sense at all. Okay, I'm not even gonna try to figure that out. The most notorious of these spurious trajectories is the case of shooting victim Paul Schrader. And that's him on the floor there after he got hit, and him in the hospital again. Bullet two, as they called this bullet that hit Schrader, one of those fired from behind Kennedy, passed through the right shoulder pad of Kennedy's suit coat without entering his body and traveled upward and forward at an 80 degree angle, like so. Okay. This bullet is alleged to have struck Schrader in the center of his forehead. It did hit him in the center of his forehead. The question is which bullet, you know, hit him. This bullet is supposed to have struck Schrader in the center of his forehead while Schrader was standing 6 to 8 feet behind Kennedy. Okay. Schrader is over here, all right, and this bullet, they went forward out of Kennedy's suit coat is supposed to have hit Schrader. Okay, just sheer nonsense. Schrader himself later said that the only way this bullet could have hit him would be if I was, quote, if I was 9 feet tall or had my head on Kennedy's shoulder. In other words, like, you know, been looking over Kennedy's shoulder, like right here, instead of back there. He says it's impossible. Author Shane Sullivan says, bullet eight pierced a one, this is another bullet now, bullet eight pierced a 1-inch thick plaster ceiling tile, ricocheted off the inner ceiling, re-entered through the tile, now traveling downward, the same 1-inch thick tile, and struck shooting victim Elizabeth Evans, also in the forehead. The medical report described the Evans bullet entering just below her hairline and traveling upward, not downward. Evans reported that she was bending to retrieve her shoe when she was hit. And O'Sullivan summarizes, three of these bullet trajectories are just not credible. Okay, now dig this. Now this is where it turns not just incompetent or, I mean it's already criminal, but now it's really seriously turning criminal. Namely the massive destruction of evidence. And we see this over and over again, like on 9/11, JFK, where the assassination of JFK, where they took away the limousine. Now, you know, imagine this. See, we have limited imagination. We accept so much crap, we can't even imagine the idiocy that these people do, and we just like, oh, okay, no problem. They took away the limousine that JFK was riding in, which was full of bullet holes, and they rebuilt it.
Full of
bullet holes, the JFK limousine. Now, they're doing the same sort of thing with Robert Kennedy. Okay, I kind of went back there. I'm not trying to confuse you. So the LAPD burned 2,400 photographs related to the Robert Kennedy shooting at the Los Angeles County General Hospital incinerator. Okay, they burned 2,400 photographs, as well as thousands of interview tapes, many of them of critical evidentiary importance. Other items of material evidence missing were at least 5 pantry ceiling tiles, a pantry door frame, and x-rays and test results on these ceiling tiles and the door frame. Melanson summarizes, crucial evidence was ignored, altered, or destroyed in a continuous systematic cover-up involving destruction of evidence, conspiracy of silence, and disinformation. The LAPD's ludicrous excuse for its criminal behavior in destroying the physical evidence was that, quote, it was too large to fit in a card file. Okay, so they're not going to keep these pieces of evidence, ceiling tiles and door frames, because they couldn't put it in a file cabinet. Okay, I mean, this just, obviously, you know, that's not even good comedy material. Concerning the 2,400 photographs burned, the department's Roy Keane assured the public, I guarantee you they were of no evidentiary value. Yeah, we'll just take your word for it. Most sickening of all was the unwarranted confiscation of film from high school student Scott Enyart, that young man there, who took what were undoubtedly invaluable photographs of the shooting itself. In the middle of the mayhem, he was standing on a table above everyone, snapping away while the shots were being fired. These crucial pantry photos, at least 10 of them, have disappeared. Okay, another problem. More guns and a second shooter were, in fact, actually seen by witnesses. 3 drawn guns were reported by witnesses, Sirhan's, uniformed security guard Thane Caesar's, and that of an unidentified man wearing a suit. And this is this guy, Caesar. The most compelling testimony of another gun having been fired is that of Don Schulman, a young man who was working at a local TV station. His account points to Caesar as the probable actual assassin. Caesar was not, and has never been, called to testify under oath. He was an extreme right-wing racist and a George Wallace supporter who felt, and openly expressed, real animus towards the Kennedys. Now, this is a guy who, you know, you would want to question who would be a likely suspect, right? At the time of the assassination, he was working as a maintenance plumber at Lockheed and started moonlighting as a security guard only 1 week before the June 4 Democratic primary. What a coincidence. In later years, he worked at Hughes Aircraft. Both of these defense contractors have close ties to the CIA. Caesar's gun was never examined, much less test-fired by the police. And even though he was not only close to, but in physical contact with Kennedy at the moment of the shooting, he was nowhere to be seen immediately afterward. Caesar is assumed to have carried the standard 38 caliber pistol of his security work, but it is known that a 22 can be built inside the frame of a 38, and that look-alike 22s and 38s are in fact made by at least one manufacturer, like so. So he, you know, you could carry around a 22. Everybody thinks you're carrying around a 38. Caesar received only one sentence in the LAPD final report, merely stating that he waited for and accompanied Senator Kennedy through the pantry. In fact, Caesar was precisely in the position which matches the starting points of the bullet trajectories described in the autopsy, that is, immediately behind and to the right of Kennedy. So there's a little diagram. And you can see right there is Sirhan, okay? There's Kennedy. Okay, there's Carl Euchre leading Kennedy. And right behind and to the right of Kennedy is Caesar, right there. There it is again, a little closer view. Except, I guess in this one, Caesar would be right here. Okay, Schulman's testimony reflects some natural confusion in the mayhem, but he clearly states, I was standing behind Kennedy and he was taking his assigned route into the kitchen. A Caucasian man stepped out and fired three times. The security guard hit Kennedy all three times. That young man that we just saw, okay, who has no reason to be lying. In fact, his life is in danger when he talks like this. Okay, he hit Kennedy all three times. Kennedy slumped to the floor. Characteristically, in a subsequent LAPD interview of Shulman, the police arrogantly told him that he did not see what he saw, that he did not see what he says he saw. In still later police interviews, says Shulman, as soon as I told them my story, they weren't interested in me. They filled out their reports, thanked me very much, and the officer who interviewed me said they had enough witnesses and none of them saw what I saw. So there's no use in even writing it down. In the 1971 interview, Shulman was a little more specific. Just then, after the shooting began, he's describing this scenario again, the guard who was standing behind Kennedy took out his gun and he fired also. The next thing I knew is that Kennedy was shot three times. Where was this guard who was firing his gun? Shulman was asked. He was standing directly to the side and back of Kennedy. He was standing on the right-hand side. I didn't see everything that happened that night because of the blinding lights and the people screaming, but the things I did see, I'm sure about. And that is, Kennedy being shot three times, the guard definitely pulled out his gun and fired. Filmmaker Ted Chirac surmises that Sirhan's first two shots missed, and then the next three came from Caesar's gun behind Kennedy, as Euchre jumped on Sirhan and Sirhan sprayed bullets at the other victims. And Chirac continues, a contract killer could not find a more efficient and concealed position to do his deed, with little chance to be seen by witnesses situated either in front of or behind the victim. Like so. So as you can see there, now, these are actors showing us where Kennedy was shot, but if you were the actual assassin, obviously, and with a short barrel gun, obviously you would be doing this a lot more surreptitiously, you know, a lot closer and hiding this from view, which you would be able to do because you're blocking the view of your gun between you and Kennedy when there's only inches of space. You know, you're sticking the gun right in there. In sum, there were two shooters, one at each of two positions, A and B. Firing position A was several feet in front of Kennedy from where Sirhan missed the senator but hit the rest of the shooting victims. Firing position B was behind and to the right of the senator, from where a second gunman fired the shots that hit Kennedy. Since Caesar, or Caesar, I never know how to say his name. Since Caesar was the one and only person seen and without question known to be in position B, he almost certainly is Kennedy's assassin. David Rayburn, now a highly respected CEO in the security industry, was an undercover operative in Los Angeles in 1968, specializing in security. He says, Sirhan was, in my opinion, a throwaway. He's what we call the shooter in the public's eye, but who the real shooter is? This level here, you get a professional. And the professional you'll never see. You'll never know anything except that they were there. That's about it. Not get out there like Sirhan did and start shooting his gun so visibly. That could have been to draw attention away from the real shooter. Now, I really should stop here because, you know, the case is closed, right? There was a second gunman, and it was probably Caesar. But, of course, the evidence keeps on building like Mount Everest. There were accomplices, okay? There's blindingly obvious, abundant, and overwhelming evidence of Sirhan having had accomplices, which proves the existence of a conspiracy, which, you know, people talk about quote-unquote conspiracy theory. Conspiracy is nothing more or less than more than one person getting together to commit a crime, basically, right? This is what this was. The LAPD's suppression of this evidence demonstrates its involvement in a cover-up and therefore in the crime itself as accessories. You can't be covering up crimes. Okay, that's a crime itself. The crucial involvement of CIA personnel in the cover-up points to that agency's complicity in the assassination as well. And of course, given CIA's power and history, it would in all probability be the principal architect of the entire criminal operation. The prime indication of an accomplice is Sirhan's ubiquitous accompaniment by a distinctive young woman, both before the June 4 primary and at the Ambassador Hotel on primary night, right up to the assassination. After the shooting, LAPD officer Sergeant Paul Chiraga That's I didn't finish this set. This guy, you know, shooting from behind. And one scenario is that while Kennedy was falling, this guy hit Kennedy in the head. That's another possibility. Anyway, so here's the Sergeant Paul Chiraga. He went to the Ambassador Hotel and encountered an older couple running into the parking lot in an agitated state. The Bernsteins, as the couple was named, told Chiraga that they had been near the exit stairs and when a young woman and a man ran past them shouting, "We shot him, we shot him." And "Who did you shoot?" asked Mrs. Bernstein to the woman. The young woman, who was wearing a polka dot dress, gleefully replied, "Senator Kennedy." Chiraga immediately put out an APB, an all-points bulletin, on the two fleeing suspects. He later noted about the Bernsteins, they were excited, but their statements were rational, not hysterical. They just didn't have time to dream up a story. It was too spontaneous. Other reports of a fleeing woman in a polka dot dress came in, but the LAPD inexplicably canceled Chiraga's APB on her and her companion. At 1:41 a.m., a policeman, another policeman, called in asking for a description of any suspect the police department might be looking for at that point. The dispatcher replied, "Disregard that broadcast. They have one man and don't want to get anything started on the big conspiracy." Okay. The LAPD had no interest whatsoever in solving this crime. They were probably involved in the crime. Not probably, they were. Okay. Along with this APB, Chiraga wrote down the couple's names and addresses. Now, when I say the LAPD, I'm not talking about necessarily, you know, all the officers on the street. I'm talking about, you know, the hierarchy. Along with his APB, Chiraga wrote down the couple's names and addresses and gave the slip of paper to a courier to take to headquarters. It later mysteriously disappeared, as did a subsequent report on the APB and the Bernsteins that Chiraga wrote up for the LAPD. In fact, the LAPD rejected, dismissed, discredited, or outright criminally falsified all of the voluminous testimony on the polka dot dress girl. Numerous witnesses claimed to have seen the suspicious woman not only at the hotel on primary night, but also earlier at Kennedy's campaign headquarters, and campaign events, where she and Sirhan seemed to be stalking him. Melanson says, "Each witness, each incident was compartmentalized by police investigators and dealt with as if it existed in a vacuum. The entire body of data, strongly suggesting a female accomplice, was never assembled or interrelated, since the LAPD decided early on that the sinister woman did not exist. Instead, the LAPD sought to extinguish each sighting as if dealing with a series of troublesome brush fires that left unchecked, could melt and burn down the lone assassin facade." Very similar and very detailed descriptions by independent witnesses, such as the following, put the question of the presence of this accomplice beyond doubt. One such description: Caucasian, 25 to 30 years old, with medium blonde, shoulder-length hair, about 5'6", a nice shape, built proportionally. Caucasian, mid-20s, 5'4 to 5'7, medium to light brown hair, 110 to 125 pounds, proportionate, attractive. 22-year-old Caucasian, 5'7", slim, excellent figure, dishwater, blonde hair. Thin, perhaps 19, but with makeup that made her appear 23 to 25. Brown or blonde shoulder-length hair, prominent nose. And a number of people described this, what they called a funny nose or a pudgy nose. Very distinctive person. At the Ambassador Hotel on the night of the assassination, several witnesses encountered this memorable young woman, now wearing a distinctive white dress with large dark polka dots. They saw her hanging around earlier in the evening with Sirhan, both of them looking out of place, and then right after the shooting, running out of the pantry with a different man or a couple of men. Okay, this woman walking around at first, hanging around, and then running out. Now, that's not a picture of her, of course. This is a recreation. Nobody ever got a picture of her, I'm sure. Or if they did, they don't know they have it. So here are two accounts among several similar ones, all utterly ignored by the LAPD. George Green went into the pantry just as the shooting was unfolding. Before he joined the struggle to overpower the assailant, he noticed a man and a woman running out of the pantry. They were conspicuous because everyone else in Green's area seemed to be trying to get in. The woman was in her early 20s, had long blonde hair, and wore a polka dot dress. Just after the shooting, amidst the confusion of the struggle to disarm Sirhan, Jack Merritt noticed two men and a woman leaving the kitchen through the back exit. The woman was approximately 5'5" tall, had light colored hair, and wore a polka dot dress. The two men wore suits. Now, I think that every 5-year-old in LA, if you know, they encountered these reports, would say, hey, you know what? This guy, Sirhan, he had an accomplice, this young woman with a polka dot dress, right? I think it's pretty obvious now. You don't need, okay, whatever. So, even more unforgettably, there was a total of at least 4 independent witness testimonies that relate the polka dot dress girl and her companion not only clearly fleeing, but also shouting, we shot him. And I told you about the burn suits just a minute ago. A second such account is the exceptionally detailed, coherent, and credible account given by 20-year-old Sandra Serrano, co-chair of the Youth for Kennedy Committee in the Pasadena area, Southern California. Uniquely among the many witnesses, she was interviewed by an NBC TV reporter on national television shortly after the shooting. And by the way, this story was so big that it was in the daily newspaper. Okay, this is not hidden in some, you know, cabinet somewhere in some dungeon. This got to be known. And this shows you how much control these people have, that they can tell us, no, you know, nobody saw this, this didn't really happen, when it's out in the open even.
What did really happen?
Hmm?
What did really happen?
That this polka dot girl didn't exist and that she wasn't accompanying Sirhan, that she wasn't an accomplice. They're trying to say that this didn't really happen. There's Sandra Serrano, and here she is, on the stairway where these people pass by. Okay, Melanson describes what happened. While waiting for the final election results, Serrano sought escape from the hot, crowded ballroom and went outside. She sat on the stairway on the 5th or 6th step. It was about 11:30 p.m. when 3 people, 2 men and a woman, climbed up the stairs. The woman said, excuse me, or she just said, excuse me, and Ms. Serrano moved aside so they could get past her. She sat there for about a half an hour and saw no one else. Then she heard what she thought were 6 car backfires. This young woman had never heard of gunfire, so she called it a backfire. Obviously, she was talking about the shooting in the pantry. Months later, a man and a woman, two of the trio she had seen previously, came running down the stairs toward her. The woman, exactly as in the Bernstein's testimony, said, we shot him. Serrano asked, who did you shoot? The woman replied, Senator Kennedy. Serrano described the woman as Caucasian, 27 years old, 5'6", with dark brown hair, wearing a white dress with black 1/4-inch polka dots. She later recognized Sirhan as one of the trio who had walked up the stairs earlier. Okay, this woman said there was Sirhan. He walked up with this woman in the polka dot dress. The woman in the polka dot dress comes running back again saying, we shot him. Okay, what else do you need? The parking lot where Chiraga met the Bernsteins was directly below the stairway. Sandra Serrano was sitting at the same time. So you have identical reports by these two people independently, right? The subsequent psychologically brutal interrogation of Serrano by Officer Lieutenant Enrique Hernandez, okay, this guy right here, completely gives away the con game being played by the LAPD and those directing it. Due to her high-profile testimony to a national audience, she absolutely had to be discredited. No method would be too egregious. She was thus utterly browbeaten by the manipulative and unscrupulous Hernandez, playing classic good cop, bad cop, until she finally recanted. And on one of the videos, they play the whole interview, and it's really, really, it's practically torture. What this guy tells Serrano, and just beating her to death, psychologically. Both Hernandez and his boss, Lieutenant Manuel Peña, lead supervisor of the LAPD unit created specifically to quote-unquote investigate the RFK assassination, and this was called Special Unit Senator, SUS. Both of these guys, Hernandez and Peña, were CIA assets. They actually were CIA assets. They had long worked for the State Department's Agency for International Development, a known CIA front involved in supporting murderous dictatorships around the world, primarily in Latin America. The CIA, in fact, has had clandestine relationships in 1968 with police departments in several U.S. cities, including L.A. During a 1973 intimate drinking session among David Morales, one of the known CIA assassins of JFK, that guy right there aren't too many good photographs of him, Ruben Carbajal, his childhood friend, and Robert Walton, his former lawyer, Morales blurted out, "We got that son of a bitch." He's talking about JFK. "And I was in Los Angeles also when we got Bobby. When Carbajal was later asked if by we Morales meant the CIA, he responded, "Goddamn right, that's what it means. Sirhan, another big problem, had no conscious motive to be killing Robert F. Kennedy. In the official story of the RFK assassination, Sirhan was an individual whose tragic childhood experience and zeal to defend his native Palestine pushed him to political violence against Robert Kennedy, a strong supporter of Israel. This is both logically and factually untenable. Fellow Democratic candidates Hubert Humphrey and Eugene McCarthy, as well as President Johnson and Richard Nixon, were all supporters of Israel. So why would Sirhan particularly attack Kennedy, whose unexceptional support of Israel was no more than standard, indeed obligatory fare for all major U.S. politicians, at least during election season? You won't find a single major U.S. politician in the past 50 years who, you know, is openly opposed to Israel and doesn't do, you know, more or less whatever Israel wants, even the most leftist of them. In fact, as Melanson puts it, in the dozens of interviews conducted with virtually everyone known to have had contact with him during their year prior to the assassination, there emerged not a single instance of Sirhan having commented on Kennedy's support for Israel, on the impact of the senator's possible presidency on Middle East politics, or on anything at all relating Kennedy to the Jews, Israel, or the Middle East. Throughout his youth, Sirhan did have strong nationalistic feelings, just like many of his fellow Arabs, but he expressed no strong political views. Instead, this alleged motive was coaxed out of him in his post-assassination hypnotic sessions with the court psychiatrist. By all accounts, Sirhan was not a violent person. He himself said to one psychiatrist, "My conscience doesn't agree with what I did. It's against my upbringing, my childhood, family, church, prayers, the Bible." Now, Sirhan wasn't even Muslim. He was Christian, even though he was from Palestine. "Thou shalt not kill. Life is the thing, you know. Where would you be if you didn't have life? And here I go and splatter this guy's brains. It's just not me." Tim, do I have some
time? It's right now 7:32. I think we ought to try to start getting into questions and rebuttals. So okay. Finish up when you can.
Okay, I'll speed through the remaining material here. So a number of psychologists examined Sirhan. Okay, very well-known psychologist, and some of them said was, Sirhan manifested a curiously detached and stereotypic view of his own political motive that seemed devoid of real conviction. They just didn't believe that he acted out this assassination consciously. They said, okay, it's like he's reading a newspaper. It lacked details. There was also Sirhan's notorious diary, okay? Have you all heard of his diary or notebook? Sirhan wrote these writings. It's not a real diary. It's mostly scribblings, this kind of thing. And it gets a lot worse than this, but there's apparently not a complete set of his quote-unquote writings, like on the internet. You only find a few pages here and there. But they get quite even more crazy than that. They're really just scribblings.
He didn't
do it consciously. He was programmed to do it. And one of these writings says RFK must die, which you can just, you know, you can see there it's kind of light. And that's what the media and everybody pounced on to say, well, there you go, you know. Well, this guy was programmed to do all of this. But I'm going to try to skip here. He was actually in trance. He was literally physically in trance. He was arrested, he started shivering, okay, coming out of this trance. And afterward, whenever he was put in a trance intentionally by a psychiatrist, he would shiver whenever he came out of a trance, okay? just like on the night that he was arrested. When he was pounced on by literally an American decathlon champion, an Olympic champion, Rayford Johnson, and a big football star, Rosie Greer, and a couple of other people, they had a hell of a time getting the gun away from him. He had like superhuman strength, and they all noticed this. And at the same time that he had the superhuman strength, he had this eerily serene, this is how they describe it, very tranquil demeanor with quote-unquote enormously peaceful eyes. This guy was completely out of his mind, okay? And so the psychologists who studied Sirhan, all of them, okay? They said Sirhan has been programmed. We disagree or don't know who did it. Some of them thought he was self-programmed because he was really into mental manipulations, mind control. He was into that sort of thing, partly because he had hurt himself. He had probably a concussion, maybe worse, when he fell off a horse because he was training to be a jockey. His dream was to become a jockey. So when that happened, he went out looking for mental help. Even after he was already the kind of person that was easily hypnotizable. He was very easily hypnotizable, extraordinarily so, naturally. And then on top of that, he goes and starts to deal with these doctors and everybody else, while the CIA, with their MKUltra, has anybody heard of MKUltra?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Their mind control program, which is very real. It was like a Manhattan-style, huge, multi-million-dollar project, at hundreds of institutions, universities, hospitals, okay? The CIA is running around looking for people to, you know, use. They have to have subjects, right? Well, the indications are, or the hypothesis is that they found Sirhan, and started to use him. So Sirhan was actually the prototypical Manchurian candidate, which was thought to be a fictional thing. This guy wrote a book and there was a movie made about the Manchurian candidate. Well, there kind of was a Manchurian candidate. That was Sirhan. Now, the problem though is that he wasn't a programmed, Sirhan was not a programmed assassin. He was a programmed patsy. Okay, there's a big difference. When you're in the state that Sirhan was in, out of your mind, you're not likely to hit your target, okay? You're not likely to do things exactly as they have to be done. So that's why you have an assassin doing the actual deed. Now, who may have been the actual person who programmed Sirhan? One likely candidate is this guy, Brian, let me see, Dr. Brian. William Joseph Brian. He was a well-known, a quote-unquote hypnosis superstar, nationally known. And as a matter of fact, he said, you can brainwash a person to do just about anything. And this guy, Brian, was consulted in the Albert DeSalvo Boston Strangler case. He hypnotized the Boston Strangler.
He was Dr. MD?
Yeah, he was a Dr. MD, yeah. And he bragged to prostitutes that he had also hypnotized Sirhan. And in one of Sirhan's notebooks, dig this, there's this sentence, and I haven't seen this image like on the internet, the actual image, but it says, God help me, please help me, salvo, DeSalvo, DeSalvo. So, but consciously, Sirhan didn't know who this guy DeSalvo was. Melanson speculates that with his outsized ego, Brian may have embedded this reference to DeSalvo in Sirhan's unconscious mind, like a crime scene trademark left by serial murderers. So they've been a couple of doctors have been working on trying to break this guy's memory barrier because they think it can be done, but they're not allowed to by the authorities, by the courts. Whenever they start to work on Sirhan, they're pulled away. Okay, go do something more useful. So the court won't allow this case to be solved. And I say, no, of course not. The oligarchy is intent on keeping this state crime like so many others, a secret and a mystery forever. But the American people are a higher court, and we can learn for ourselves what our rulers are really doing to us, and we can decide to end their reign of terror altogether. Thank you.
Sirhan now. What happened to Sirhan?
Okay, Sirhan was sentenced to death, the death penalty. He was given the death penalty at the time. This would have been 1968 or 1969. So, you know, you get on death row, and he was sitting there on death row. And California, there was a law passed that abolished the death sentence in California, so it was changed to life in prison. Sirhan was a good model prisoner because he wasn't a violent guy by nature. But every time he came up for parole, it was denied. So he's sitting, rotting in prison still to this day.
Oh, really?
He's 72 years old.
Whoa.
David Singer.
I think we all can rule out the left as being a person on the left as having committed this crime. What would the right wing gain by getting rid of the Kennedys? You know, the majority of the American people don't believe the story of the assassinations, but they have serious doubts about them. And, you know, I'm among them. Kennedy, you know, did a lot of talk of both Kennedys about the poor and about helping non-whites and stuff.
Yeah.
But that should be threatening to them.
What do you mean by them? You said the right wing.
Yes,
that's
right.
Kind of amorphous. What I'm talking about is the establishment, basically the billionaire class.
Yes.
The Rockefellers, the Morgans.
They should welcome people like the Kennedys.
The Kennedys wanted to change the economy to work for, and the government, to work for ordinary people. Those guys like Rockefeller and Morgan, the actual oligarchy of the United States, their entire business is sucking us dry and sucking the whole world dry of resources, of labor, of money. That's why nobody's pay ever goes up.
Yeah, but the Kennedys were part of...
No, that's where you're wrong, and that's where a lot of people are wrong. A lot of people just have no idea of what the Kennedys were about. And like I said, unfortunately, I didn't have time either in that last time or this time to get into that. I should probably do that as soon as I can.
Yeah.
But that's a story in itself.
Steve
Congas.
Yeah.
Hey, Ted. Hey, so I get the concept about the 8-shot revolver. And then you said there were like 13 shots. So is it possible, and I'm hoping, that the security guards for Kennedy, they pulled their guns out and started shooting?
Shooting
is that possible?
Shooting at like trying to hit Sirhan?
Yeah, isn't that possible? I hope they pulled their guns.
Okay, a couple of guns were seen being pulled, but the only person that was seen shooting was this guy, Caesar. And he was right behind Kennedy, apparently shooting at Kennedy. Well, Kennedy was shot from behind, so regardless of what any security guard was trying to do, somebody definitely shot Kennedy, and that was likely the security guard who was right behind him. So it just, am I answering your question?
Yeah, well, 13 bullets were flying around.
Yeah.
And I'm just hoping that some of the security guards shot their gun.
Yeah, this guy, Cesar, was a security guard, and he did shoot his gun, but he shot it at Kennedy to kill Kennedy.
All right. Mike Weiner, and then Sid Cohen. Ted, you said that Bobby was saying that he wanted a new investigation opened up into the death of his brother.
Yeah.
Where could a person substantiate that he said that or wrote that or whatever?
I don't have the quotes right in front of me, but he said, okay.
Well, I mean, what is your source of saying that? It has to be something that you read or...
Yeah, I did read it. There's
verified.
No. Yes, I said, like I said, I don't have the citation in front of me, but there's no question that that's what he was intending to do, and he told people he was intending to do that, and he also told them that he was waiting to become the president. because he thought that the presidency was the only power high enough or great enough to attack the case again. Because the establishment had been fending off all these attempts, like this guy Garrison, I think was his name, in New Orleans. He started a trial on the John F. Kennedy assassination, but it was beat back by the CIA and many others, the authorities. They didn't allow it to go through properly and come up with a conviction of the assassin of John F. Kennedy.
Yeah, but assuming that I just didn't want to take your word for it, you know, how could I
look it
independently
up,
substantiate?
Either I'll get back to you or look it up on the internet. This is in the sources.
You made it up.
Just Google it.
Yeah, right. That's a good
one. You can believe whatever you read on the internet.
You
made it up.
No. Hold on. I don't rely on the internet. I'm telling you to look up on the internet because I'm not telling you to read a dozen books like I wrote, like I read.
Oh. Gone.
Yeah, Robert Kennedy worked with Joe McCarthy, and
yeah.
He was very reactionary at that point, and you said he was liberal.
Mm-hmm.
What made him a liberal?
That's a good question. When he started out, he was not a flaming radical lefty or anything of the sort. At least not openly. As a politician, he did work with Joseph McCarthy in the beginning, and he wasn't known to, and he pursued organized crime. He wasn't known to be particularly liberal. The Kennedys, unlike these other tools of the establishment, evolved in office. Okay, they learned. They saw what was going on. They saw the monster from the inside, the empire from the inside, and they decided they didn't want to be a part of it. So one of the things that's very striking and important about both Kennedys is that as they matured, as they gained experience in government, they started to change their ways and their ideas, which were never really down deep inside right wing. They were not right wingers to begin with, but they played the political game. And you know, talked about the Cold War and the Russians, etc., to some degree, to get elected and to succeed, and because that's the way. You know how right wing and how Cold War oriented the country was in the 1950s, for instance. Okay, everybody used the same rhetoric, et cetera, including the Kennedys. They evolved; others did not.
Yes, Gene Harker, and then Paul Roron.
With the conspiracy, I'm pretty kind of confused on this. Was there a certain number of people in there, and did they all know what was going on, or did they each know a part of it? How did that? How would you describe that?
There were a number of witnesses who saw substantially.
No, the conspirators.
Oh, well, say that again. Okay, so what's the question? Conspirators. What about it?
Yeah, you say it's a conspiracy. So there must have been some people involved. Did they all know what was going on, or did they know just a part of it?
Okay,
how did that work?
I see what you're saying. You know, I've never been a part of a conspiracy like of this kind, so I couldn't answer that definitively. But there are various levels, okay? And this is something that I've been studying, and I'll continue to study, and I'll put together soon. It's like the next step. At the top is the billionaires, literally, like David Rockefeller, okay, the Morgans. There used to be a set of them, a half dozen, who everybody knew: Morgan, Rockefeller, Vanderbilt, Mellon. Okay, nowadays it's a little bit more diffuse, so they don't stand out as much. But there's still these guys at the very top. And they don't write down orders, you know. They don't do anything so stupid and explicit. They wink and nod, and they get together with their underlings at their clubs, and that's something a phenomenon that is very important. These high level people, they meet in these clubs of theirs, exclusive clubs, where they can do things in private. Okay, so they tell the next level, okay, we want this done. Or they just let them know. They don't necessarily even have to speak the words, kill Robert F. Kennedy. They let them know. And so then you get down to the CIA level, like the Dulleses. The Dulles brothers, throughout the 50s and 60s, or 40s, 50s, 60s, whatever, okay, they were the operators that did what the really high upper class wanted. And so they controlled the State Department, they controlled the CIA, Allen Dulles. Okay, and then you go down to the agents that they control, and then you get down to the assassins, the actual assassins, including the mafia, the Cuban exiles, etc. Okay, so it's diffused down all the levels, and I think what you were referring to is that at the lowest level, you're right, the ordinary assassin doesn't have to have the whole story, the whole plan. And probably won't. They'll just know what they're supposed to do.
Thank you.
Paul? Yeah, the official narrative of all this, how do they explain away Sirhan, supposed to be this Palestinian loner? How does he know where Kennedy's going to be, and how does he know, how does he gain access, and how does he plan all this?
They never asked him, they never determined it, they didn't come out in court. They never found out anything, basically. The defense in Sirhan's case said, okay, we agree, it's called stipulate. We stipulate that Sirhan killed Kennedy, it was his gun, he intended to, etc. Their only defense was he was insane. It was like an insanity defense. So nobody ever in the authority world ever determined what the heck Sirhan was trying to do, or why?
For what? How was he even there?
Anyway. Well, okay, that was a public event. Anybody could be at.
But how did he know he was going through the kitchen at that time? I mean, is that?
Well, there were a lot of people in the kitchen waiting for him to come through. Now the operatives would find that out. Sirhan himself wouldn't know anything. He didn't know anything. He was out of his mind.
But how did the government explain that?
The government didn't explain anything in this case. It did the opposite of explain. It threw up lie after lie after lie.
All right, Ileana.
Then why didn't you? What do you think? Why didn't you choose to come?
Speak up, please.
Why not another? Why not another somebody? Why they pointed to Sirhan?
Okay. What was the first part of your question?
Why not somebody? I mean, I understand what you said, but why they even pointed to Sirhan?
Why Sirhan specifically? Yeah. Well, when you need a patsy, first of all, there are a lot of potential patsies out there, people who can be used and manipulated.
Right.
Sirhan was a good suspect or a good choice because he was Palestinian, so they could say, okay, you're a Palestinian, therefore you're going to go kill. A pro-Israeli politician. Mm-hmm. Like I said, he was very hypnotizable, and they found that out somehow or other. He was kind of a meek guy, actually. Okay, there were a lot of victims who fell under the MK Ultra operation. They eliminated a whole lot of people, and you didn't have to be a weak person. These people have all kinds of powers, and they can. Pluck people out of anywhere and use them and use their weaknesses or whatever.
Thank you,
Charlie.
Yes, Ted. What does it mean that you can just hypnotize people, pick them out of anywhere? What branch of clinical psychology says you can program people like this? Do you realize we could take care of all disturbed behavior in the world, if we could achieve that? What branch of psychology are you referencing?
These guys.
What give me a name of a personality theorist, a school, a location, a college, a university. You say you just hypnotize people to kill people?
Oh, no.
Where?
First of all, I mentioned a number of doctors. There was Dr. Diamond, Dr. Simpson. Those are the two that come to my mind right offhand. Those were psychiatrists. They're professionals. In the Sirhan case, they studied Sirhan and they said this guy was programmed.
What does it mean?
have never encountered the term programming in the field of clinical psychology.
Okay, here's
the first time I've heard of this. That's
okay.
These guys,
the program assassins or patsies. Okay,
how?
They're not necessarily interested in solving the actual psychological issues and problems of the day. They're hired by the CIA. Okay. First of all. Secondly, I'm not a psychiatrist. You're not a psychiatrist. Who's to say that that people can't be programmed? A number of people said, I told you, this guy Brian.
The burden of proof is on you.
I just told you that these guys, Brian, Simpson, Diamond, what more do you want? Do you want 500 psychiatrists? I don't have that off the top of my head.
Two names.
I just told you.
There's no books on this?
There is this guy, book by Philip Melanson. That's one of my sources. Another one by Shane O'Sullivan, okay? And a couple others.
You have Google. Google. It's right in front of you there.
This is crazy.
It is kind of crazy, okay? But crazy doesn't mean not real. There's a lot of crazy stuff going on.
Okay.
Johnson Barton McGill.
Yeah, you said RFK gave a Kansas speech a couple days after announcing his candidacy. I'm interested in the context of how... I don't know, the imagination, the capacity to envision another type of America in the psyche of the American public. Kansas is now the place that's most known for the Koch brothers, and it used to be arguably the most radically progressive place in the country, which is no small detail considering it's smack dab in the center of the United States. That's not something that I take to be a minor issue in this whole overall analysis. Could you talk more about what struck out to you about that Kansas speech, or what you think we should take away from the significance of talking about ending the Vietnam War, which is a huge, you know, signal to the military-industrial complex, we're taking a new direction?
A little bit more specific. What should I... What?
Did anything impress you from the Kansas speech in regards to RFK's willingness to appeal to our most progressive imagination amongst the public, being that Kansas used to be one of the most radically progressive states in the country?
Well, yeah, I think RFK, well, first of all, he got that kind of positive reception everywhere he went. I don't think Kansas is as unique as you're making it out to be. Kennedy, Robert F. Kennedy, JFK as well, but Robert Kennedy was really a cool guy when you look at him a little more closely. He that's what he was all about, was trying to get the better nature out of people and to try to bring peace. One of the most moving things about, I mean, when you study Kennedy, you read a lot about of moving things that he said and did. But one of the most moving was his speech after King was killed. He went to Indianapolis on the night that King was killed, and he gave this speech that has been called the most amazing speech ever. You can look it up, April 4. And he didn't have to necessarily, you know, go into a black community and because it was deemed unsafe. Hardly anybody would have even dared or risked going into a volatile situation like this. This was in 1968, when there were literally riots burning down cities. He dared to go into these people's community and give them the bad news. You know, it was quite something.
Okay.
What?
Let's see, Peter.
How many shots did Ceron fire and did they hit Kennedy?
He fired at Sirhan. Okay, Sirhan. No, Sirhan didn't hit Kennedy. He shot twice in the general direction of Kennedy, but hit instead a couple of the other people behind him. And then they grabbed his arm. Yuka grabbed his arm, his hand, his gun hand. And the guy kept on shooting and emptied his gun. So he shot eight times. He hit five people beyond Kennedy, but not Kennedy, because, as I explained, Kennedy's shots were from behind. So Sirhan did shoot off all the bullets in his gun, eight of them, and hit five people.
Okay.
Did they ever establish the identity of the girl in the polka dot dress?
No, no, no. They had no intention. That's the opposite of what they wanted to do.
I mean, have any of your sources that speculated?
No, not that I know.
All she did was leave the room, so they said,
"Any questions?"
One more question back here.
Okay, well, last one.
Last one. Doug, you're the last.
Do you have a take on why the why Edward Kennedy and other Kennedys have been so lackadaisical in their public statements about the two assassinations? And Edward Kennedy went to his death, and there was no safe deposit box or any statements that were sent on the internet to be, you know, disseminated after his death. So I find that very just inexplicable to me. Do you have any take on that?
Yeah, I have something of an explanation. When after John F. Kennedy was killed, Robert Kennedy was reluctant to come out and say, "Well, this is a conspiracy. This is, you know, the CIA is doing, et cetera, et cetera," because these are all public figures, and to say something like that out loud at that level of level is the end of your career. And what would it achieve? Because he felt Robert Kennedy felt that he had to become president. He had to succeed John F. Kennedy as president to solve the murder of John F. Kennedy. So after each generation, so to speak, they're all brothers, but kind of, you know, generation, John F. Kennedy, Robert F. Kennedy, Edward Kennedy, after each quote-unquote generation, there is less, there's more reluctance and less ability to get to the bottom of things. They want to continue their careers. Another thing is that just because Edward Kennedy's a Kennedy doesn't mean he has the same fiber as John and Robert, who I think were much deeper and more fighters. Does that answer your question?
He could have had things on a server to be released.
Edward Kennedy?
Edward Kennedy
might have been more a part of the establishment. He might have made his peace. You know how many people in government with the CIA, the NSA, the FBI, the Department of Defense, all, you know, these thousands, millions of government employees have to pretty much eat the crap and not come out and go with the flow?
Tim, what time do we have?
It's right now 8:02. We should get into rebuttals.
Rebut.
Charles. Ted, after 50-some years, how many individuals could you have come forth and said, "We shot Kennedy. They were part of the conspiracy"? Do you have any names?
Yeah, David Morales.
Said there was a conspiracy?
He didn't only say there was a conspiracy. He said, "We shot Kennedy," quote unquote, "We shot Kennedy." David Morales.
Didn't Hunt confess on his
Hunt confessed killing or being involved with John F. Kennedy. There were a number of other people. There were a number of people who confessed John F. Kennedy. The Robert F. Kennedy assassination has been kept much more buried. In fact, there was never an official investigation like there was
one. He wants me to take it off.
He went to the police and said there was a conspiracy.
David Morales?
Yeah, he went.
You don't go to the police. This guy was a CIA agent. He admitted this to his buddies.
You mean that drinking?
Yeah, right.
That was it. But no one. This is a court.
Thank you.
And he said, you don't have the names of the.
These are insiders.
They don't
go to courts and talk about their crimes.
Night, and he said something in the bar that, yeah, we got. That's it.
I don't know.
You don't have the name. Who were the conspirators?
The conspiracy of Robert Kennedy has not been completely unraveled, as far as the actual individuals involved.
No names.
It has not been narrowed down to who the actual conspirators were.
Not one.
No, we're talking about the fact of a, I have been talking about the fact of a conspiracy, clearly. The individuals who were actually involved, we don't really know that. That, but that doesn't mean that it wasn't there.
Rebut.
Who did it?
So,
come on.
Now we have our period. By the way, if you have questions,
just leave it on.
To my eyes.
You can
to my eyes.
Make that over, your rebuttal. So, how many rebuttals do we have?
Someone needs it for timing.
That's
yours.
5 minutes. No longer than 5 minutes.
Watch yourself. Be all right.
Is anybody sitting right there?
No, go ahead.
I learned about the Robert Kennedy assassination when I was working on a night job on a railroad. You know, it was after the sun had risen. But the only assassination in the draft at the time, and one of the choices was to go to Canada. I never wanted to do that, except after, I never really thought about it, except after the Kennedy assassination. You know, the Martin Luther King assassination, the riots and so on. I never really took it up. But that's what I was thinking of at the time. Now, Sherman Skolnick was on this pretty quick, and he said something about a famed Eugene Cesar who shot Kennedy. I don't remember that much about it, but I mean, this guy, our speaker mentioned, he didn't pronounce it the same way, but I presume it's the same. The same person. Skolnick also got a document into the court records called, or a couple pages of what he called the Blakey Report. And a line in the Blakey Report is that a federal appellate judge is murdered in Chicago and no meaningful inquiry can result because of a network of corruption that permeates Chicago law enforcement. This judge's name was W. Lynn Parkinson, who had stiffed, I guess, the wrong people on some patent cases. I wish people would take a more systematic approach to untoward influences on public officials, like death threats and owning stocks and other financial I tried to get a federal judge out of my draft case for owning bank stocks and making money off the war. Did anybody care about it? Well, I didn't at the time, and I still don't see why anybody really cares about it now. But if you don't care about things like this, what's going to happen? You're just going to go on and on and on forever. The only defense I want to make against the draft is that it's unconstitutional. When the framers said raise and support armies, they meant a paid professional army, not conscripts. There is compulsory military service, but it's under the militia clause, not the army clause, which is another story altogether. But a young friend of mine was shot in 1972 on the L on the south side, and he lingered along for a few hours, like Robert Kennedy did after being shot. I saw him lying in state. He had his top of his head was all bandaged up. So I guess that's about all I gotta say right now.
All right.
I'm not going to rebut anything that Ted said about the assassination, exactly how it went down. I wasn't there, so I can't really say anything. Before I say any more, Ted and I were brothers in the Occupy movement and the labor working group, and we both were fighting the good fight that we did then, and we continue to do so. I hope, Ted, I hope that you miss the Occupy movement as much as I do, because I really miss it. And my rebuttal just relates to his characterization of your characterization of Bobby, as far as being anti-establishment. You know, I was there. I'm older than you are, and I had, you know, some maturity and some cognizance then. I was very precocious for a two-year-old in 1968. Yeah, but okay. No, he was brought in as an alternative or perhaps a spoiler in 1968. Okay, Eugene McCarthy talking against the war, and he's winning primary after primary. He had won Wisconsin, which then had an earlier primary than it did now. So Wisconsin's primary predated the announcement that that Kennedy made in March 18th of his candidacy. Okay, before he announced his candidacy, well, I should say, before McCarthy was winning all these primaries, Bobby had not said word one against the war in Vietnam, okay? And his polls were down. And he starts, the machine starts saying, oh, we can't have McCarthy. No, we have to bring in someone else to either spoil it or take the lead. And so they have him starting to say some negative things about Vietnam. His poll results go up, and they convince him to announce his candidacy. And it was totally to derail Eugene McCarthy, who, though he may have not had a charisma of a Kennedy, was winning every primary. And, well, not every primary, but he was in the lead. Okay, this thing about RFK being beloved by working urbanites, no. He was sicked upon the labor movement by his brother, like a pit bull. And they made an example out of Jimmy Hoffa, and he totally attacked the labor movement, and it wasn't the true unionism, but it's what the working people had, and this organization, the International Brotherhood of Teamsters, did a lot. International truckers got a real good wage and very good benefits. They were like semi-skilled, but they got paid wages, and they got benefits equivalent to skilled tradespeople, like tool and die makers and so forth, and that was the exertion that the Teamsters gave to the employers. Now, did they rely on certain unsavory elements to help them with that? Yes. And did those unsavory elements expect something in return? Yes. But that was what happened when the companies hired goons, Pinkertons, to beat the crap out of unionizing workers, out of organizers, out of picketers, and the government is providing no assistance. What is the working people to do when unsavory elements come up and say, we can help you, we got some muscle? So to make an example out of the union people, out of the Teamsters who are the victims, and only exercising their power in the labor market, is he was not the dear candidate of working people, and especially of union organized people, and it was disingenuous of him to pretend that he was. And wanted to respond. Kmart actually didn't exist as a name back then. There was the Kresge company, and it was Kresge, and they became Kmart later. A very minor thing.
Okay.
The woman in the polka dot dress. Did they see what Ethel was wearing that evening?
5 minutes, Sid.
I read a book a number of years ago by Oliver Stone, the filmmaker. And the book was about American imperialism all over the world. And he goes into different aspects of it. In Latin America, of course, in the Philippines, in Greece, and so forth and so on. And then he gets into the period during the Cuban Missile Crisis. And, of course, everybody knows what happened that was living at that time. If they don't, well, they read books about it anyways. What really happened, where the world was on the brink of disaster and was very fearful period where Khrushchev and Kennedy faced each other about the missiles that Khrushchev put into Cuba.
Right.
And at that particular time, Khrushchev didn't notify Castro that eventually he had to pull him out because of what happened when the ships from the Soviet Union came very close to colliding with the American ships, and we almost had World War III. And what happened during that period is what Oliver Stone gets into, and that is that the Kennedys were so fearful that the world was going to end, and this made him fear the fact that the Cold War was still going on. And according to Stone, that's what made him change his mind about the Cold War, that if he didn't do something, eventually we'd have World War III, and that's why he was assassinated. So according to this theory, Robert Kennedy had the same thing because he was involved in the whole process. And he became more or less, his Cold Warrior days more or less ended according to this report. Now, how true it is, I don't know. But that's what changed his mind, and that's what changed his mind about seeking peace, and that's another reason why he was assassinated according to this theory, because the real powers that be in the United States didn't want the Cold War to end. How else would they be making their billions and millions and having their bases all around the world? And how would the American capitalism keep succeeding in this type of a process? So either he had to be killed or it might be the end of the Cold War.
The highest level overseer of the cartel in 1973 said something in a speech to the nation, I'll paraphrase. In any organization, the one at the top must bear the responsibility. The responsibility, therefore, belongs here in this office. I accept that, and I pledge to you tonight from this office that I will do everything in my power to ensure that the guilty are brought to justice and that such abuses are purged from our political process in the years to come, long after I have left office. Some people, quite properly appalled at the abuses that occurred, will say that it demonstrates the bankruptcy of the political system. It is essential now that we place our faith in the system, and especially in the judicial system. So just, you know, put the mental image with you of him saying that with the overseer of the cartel in 1973, better known as Richard Milhouse Nixon. So what he's explaining is a pretty serious crime, a break-in at the Democratic headquarters, but that's small potatoes, well, what skeletons had got in their closet, and that's why a lot of these guys at that time are so cavalier. Just think about the 1990 film masterpiece, brilliant triumph of art and storytelling, Goodfellas by Martin Scorsese, where in a courtroom scene, Henry Hill, played by Ray Liotta, is sitting there in the courtroom, and he's got, you know, amazing backdrop there, not just to tell about organized crime, but something far more relevant to the analysis of what's behind the curtain of the empire, especially in the last 70 years. He gets up out of his seat in the film, okay, and he looks right in the camera, and the flag's right behind him, and he says, "It didn't matter. It didn't mean anything. When we were broke, we would go out and rob some more. We ran everything. We paid off cops. We paid off lawyers. We paid off judges. Everybody had their hands out. Everybody was for the taking." Now think about those two things together, and you'll see what they're really saying. It's very similar to the feelings that we got after the terrible events in September of 2001, when the next overseer of that time said, "Now you're either with us or against us." And it never even occurred to these people that we're with neither and against both. And what they're essentially saying in both these moments in history, where there's a fork in the road where we the people can choose true sovereignty, true autonomy, or once again, what they consider to be democracy, they're saying essentially, don't question, don't debate, don't mobilize, don't assemble, don't disagree, don't be independent, don't voice a grievance, don't be alert, don't be aware, don't organize, don't disobey, don't go outside officially designated boundaries of opinion, and if you dare to do so under no circumstances, don't have any discussions with strangers about system change. That's what he's essentially saying, with no shame at all. Now, we can't let ourselves get fooled again. We have to call the overseers on their bluff, and we have to sharpen our skills of readiness to not be duped again by the mainstream media the next time an environmental crisis happens, the next time a financial collapse happens, the next time an unjust war happens, the next time, you know, somebody's gerrymandered out of office, coverage is pretty much censoring or just completely misrepresenting the candidate, or like recently in Arizona, they just have a couple, you know, dozen or over 100 less polling places in one of the most hottest, you know, election spots in the country. There's all kinds of ways that they can do this now in far more stealthy ways. What we're saying is basically is, you know, whoever it is, the fossil fuel industry, the surveillance complex, the International Monetary Fund, the World Trade Organization, the World Bank, the military-industrial complex, or trade deals like the Trans-Pacific Partnership that void all of we the people's autonomy, so then we can have as many progressive Bernie Sanders or Jill Steins or somebody even more progressive. I mean, think of about your most dream candidate to be the highest level of office. For me, personally, it would be, I don't know, Alice Walker, Noam Chomsky. Imagine that. If we have a trade deal in the world that pretty much says whatever they say can be overruled because somebody is more important and unaccountable and unelectable to the people. So when somebody says, you know, we ran everything, we could pretty much do whatever we want, everyone was for the taking, our minds of we the people are not for the taking. Our proposals, ideas, our visions, our dreams, our strategies, our cooperations, we don't have our hands out for that, because that's something they'll never get.
Jonathan!
All right. Andy! When you're ready, Andy.
Hey, John.
Yeah, right.
For those of you that may not have heard any of my talks here in the past 8 years on blacked out censored news, Ted hit on one of the key points, and the speaker just got through listing how the media in America, the billionaires of the media consider their jobs, their job description, is to make a ton of money and keep the American people in a bubble of terrifying ignorance on certain issues. Kind, decent, college-educated people in America are among the most terrifyingly ignorant people on the face of the earth when it comes to certain issues that are common knowledge all over the world. I was laying in a tire trench in Vietnam during the Tet Offensive in 1968. I had the sense not to run for a bunker when the rockets and mortars coming into our basins near Saigon went off. I was an Air Force base called Binh Hoa. I was a helicopter aircraft mechanic. I spent my time two tours in Vietnam fixing bullet holes and wire harnesses, fixing radios and stuff for the Huey gunships. So after the experience that I experienced on the ground over there, I started reading everything I could get my hands on when I got out in 69. Censor News, for those of you who don't know, it published a book every year. It's called Project Censored. It's the top 25 stories of the year that are blacked out by the mainstream media that would change the country overnight if they were covered rather than blacked out. They teach journalism students how not to get fired and blackballed if you're going to be a journalist. Charles H. Ferguson wrote a book called Predator Nation. In this book, there's a chapter on the ivory tower. Where's Merchants Redoubt? Naomi Oreskes and Eric M. Conway wrote this book a few years back. I think it was 2004 or something like that, called Merchants of Doubt. This book describes the tobacco strategy. You hire professors to produce reports saying there's no problem with secondhand smoke, there's no problem with global warming, there's no problem with climate change. Charles Ferguson's book has a chapter called The Ivory Tower, what Bobby Kennedy today calls biastitutes. Intellectual prostitutes in the biological fields or something, they're paid to produce reports that are knowingly false. A professor can get $250,000 entering his report into the record and testify before Congress for an hour, and then it goes out mainstream. Here's two books. In 1980, Amory Lovins published a book called Energy and War, Breaking the Nuclear Link. In 1980, this book laid out the financial, moral, ethical, philosophical disaster of nuclear power all over the world. This book has been validated in spades by thousands of other scientists everywhere. He got it right in 1980. Just recently, a couple of years ago, here's a guy named Michael J. Fox that produced a book called Why We Need Nuclear Power. This is one of the most brilliantly written, smooth pieces of intellectual prostitution that I have ever seen. Reading this book is like reading a history of the Vatican by a guy that claimed he never heard of the Pope. The Bulls without Michael. Who's this Michael guy that was supposed to be in Chicago? This is what we're up against with well-financed people writing books, articles. For those of you that haven't seen it, at the head of the list since 1935, here's a book called War is a Racket. The new edition has an introduction by former Governor Jesse Ventura. He describes how the billionaires want to keep the war machine going because war is profitable. It doesn't matter how many you kill, doesn't matter how much the environment you destroy. It's for short-term, 90-day profits. And if we don't face it, we're in the territory that Naomi Klein is talking about when she wrote this book. This changes everything. This will be one of my top 10 lists of recommended books of all time. It tells where we are, what the problems are, what we're up against. I'm going to be talking about a summary of this book and several others on April 30th, 4 weeks from tonight here. We'll have literature, printouts, summaries. If any of you are interested in knowing what's really going on in the world, come here April 30th. It's a fact that we've got a new piece of literature coming out, Facts Without Politics. This book is a physics textbook. It's not somebody's opinion. There's no opinion here. It's a physical textbook that just simply recorded the physical evidence, the forensic evidence of what happened on the day of 9/11. For those of you that don't know, all seven buildings of the Trade Center were destroyed that day by some coalition of demolition experts that prepped the buildings weeks in advance. The media, the billionaires, set up cameras to film the first two. The dust clouds formed, and they said the buildings collapsed. The two twin towers spread over lower Manhattan as a cloud of dust. That whole thing, incidentally, the last thing I'll mention is Project Censored, Censored 2011. This edition has the culmination of 5 years worth of investigative work out of Sonoma State University from 26 to 2011, helping people understand how the public is fed mythology and kept in a bubble of ignorance. We puncture that bubble of ignorance, and we can take the $1 trillion our military is wasting all over the world
and begin to move toward the campaign that Bernie is talking about. Last thing, for those of you that don't know, Bernie is actually winning the vote tolls around the country, and the media is reporting that Hillary is winning when she's actually losing the actual on-the-ground vote totals. It's the greatest media blackout of a political candidate running for president of a party that this country has seen since Franklin Roosevelt. So there's good things happening, and anybody wants any cards with the websites on, come see me when this is over. Thank you.
I'll go next, Bob. Okay, hang on, we got it.
The empire brings peace. The empire brings us security. The rise of the United States over the next 100 years is going to make sure that we maintain a peaceful world. Remember, he who has the biggest guns wins. If we keep our influence around the world great with a large military, if we keep subjugating nations under our clasp, we keep our sea lanes open by intimidating those foreign countries. We keep our trade goods flowing by manipulation of the system. We win. We keep the free flow of capital running.
Yeah.
We win. Come on, brother.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Very good, Sam. Viva capitalism.
Thank you, Darth.
I have this stuff.
Hey, let's get a happy one, Charlie.
All right, let's thank our speaker. Okay. Another detailed presentation.
Gentlemen,
I don't know which way I'm going to go on this. It's not a topic I admit to having looked into at all. I did hear something here, such great alarm, like, how did this gentleman get in there? How did Sirhan get in there? On my cell phone, it says, "Hey, Charles, this is Dan with Bernie 2016. Come hang out with us and Che Garcia. It's going to be a real plus money." This is on March 15th. Anybody involved in politics can go to these winning receptions, depending particularly if you're involved in the campaign. It's no big thing. I've been at Republican ones, and I was going to go over to Hillary's just to see what was going to go on for have some fun. But that's no issue. But then again, I hear some great thing like this could be added to the conspiracy thing. How did he get in there? How did he get entry to that place? See what I mean? There's no explanation. It's amazing, you know, there's a thing called a cold case. After 50 years, you cannot accuse not one single, give me the name, of one conspirator who should be arrested and prosecuted. All the rest of the, I don't know where you're coming from, but if you have a crime are committed by individuals, by people, you call them, put them on a stand, cross-examine them, present evidence. That's where your evidence comes in. You present it and work it into a cross-examination. But it doesn't stand alone. It doesn't establish anything. If we don't know it, and then I'm told, well, and then there's a higher level called the oligarchy, but they don't say who they are and why. Well, this is a tough one. We don't know who's doing this, and we very conceivably never will. But I don't know, that's work to do. Other things is, I saw a thing where a girl in a polka dot dress went up the stairs to the event, and she got out of there when things got
a little difficult. So the girl in the polka dot dress went to the event, and then she left the event. What? I didn't understand what that established. There are a lot of people who went to it and left. I'm told numbers of them. Does this mean there's something going on? I mean, people came here tonight and will leave here tonight. Does that mean there's some dark conspiracy? Now, last of all, I've been spending a lot of time in my life studying psychology, and I want to know what this programming thing is. I mean, this has some significant application. I'd like to do this with my friends and relatives if I could. Particularly you guys. Now, if we could take military personnel and somehow program them to kill and make them just an efficient, unethical military force. Now, the other thing is, I'm a union person, and I'm a little concerned that they may be programming employees.
Uh-oh.
Saying, you will not come late to work. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Or you will work. You will work for less pay. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I don't really know about this. You can hypnotize somebody like that. It would be wonderful if we could control behavior that easily and explicitly, because there's a lot of aberrant activities of people who are suffering disturbances, and we can't stop them. I mean, it was that simple, let's say, to stop. You could take care of drug abuse or smoking or things of that nature. So we don't have quite those controls over human behavior. And to say that, well, there's some hypnotic programming process, I don't accept this. Now, the other thing I heard is that somehow this thing was brought before a House committee. What House committee? House committees aren't really courts. They bring testimony and then they formulate actions for a government agency, and appropriate funds are not for the ensuing year. Now, if they did have evidence of an investigation was merited, they have the authority to incorporate it, and these are written in the books, kind of like instructions or activities for that agency for the coming year. All the agencies have them, and it's called their appropriations. If there was, in fact, activities to pursue an investigation, why was it not incorporated in the appropriation for that, for whatever that committee, I don't know which one it would be, for the ensuing year? It is not the thing to decide plus or negative that either way on this. That's not what committees do. They're not courts, and they don't operate anything in that fashion or thoroughness. Okay. But all right, thank you very much.
Charles must kill.
$2 an hour.
$2 an hour.
Okay, Brahm.
Programmed to kill Brahm.
Well, RFK is long dead. And we're still around. It doesn't look like there's going to be any prosecution of anyone other than Sirhan Sirhan. I doubt that he will get out. So what is the upshot of all this? Oh, there was a conspiracy by David Rockefeller and the other Rockefellers and Mellons and, I don't know, DuPonts, maybe who else? I'm sure there are conspirators. There are lots of people with influence in our society. What are we going to do? Perhaps perhaps Sid's theory of the opposition to the Cold War on the part of certain Kennedys, particularly Robert, might have alarmed people who thought that would make a big difference, and that Kennedy might actually have won the presidency. There's some doubt in my mind as to whether Robert Kennedy would have gotten the nomination of the Democratic Party. That's all conjecture, and I'd much rather go to next week's program, where we will hear about one candidacy that seems to be quite significant in the thinking of a lot of people about the economic welfare of the United States, of particular classes of people in our society, and I hope that I'll see you there.
Okay. Our speaker gets the last word. Let's welcome Ted.
Yeah.
All right, Ted.
They're going to get him for making this speech.
The only guy he's going to get this guy.
Sid still here?
No.
Sid left.
Okay, anyway, I'll tell him what you said, though.
It'll be online.
He was right on spot, as far as I was concerned. The Kennedys are misunderstood. Now, as for whether Robert F. Kennedy, what his relationship was with the unions was, I'm not sure. I didn't study his entire career, right? Certainly not that early part of his career, and not carefully anyway. But certainly by 1968, Kennedy was a progressive person. I'm going to do, I've been studying this, and I'll study it more, and I'm going to make a presentation sometime that will be more focused, if not exclusively, on the Kennedys and what they were about, because really that's misunderstood. But like I said, Sid hit it right on the head. They really did realize that the Cold War was mass suicide, mass insanity, and it couldn't go on. But the military-industrial complex was intent on keeping it going, so there was a fatal collision there. Fatal for the Kennedys, unfortunately. Charlie, I don't know how much evidence I have to show you that people were controlled. I mean, these psychiatrists, they explained it quite explicitly.
Can I just say one thing?
Of course.
There's an old-timer at the college, Vern McCloskey, and I know all about this thing. Rosie Greer went to beat him up. He was a reporter. Because he raised issues about this, what took place, and they have saved her from getting the shit knocked out of her.
Okay, well,
John Kennedy's assassination in 1963, Bobby's wilderness.
Okay, I don't know anything about that. I'll just say one more thing, because your comments weren't that extensive, so. Somebody said something about Nixon. I didn't get that, John. I'm going to have to ask you to explain that. But anyway, let me just go say one last thing. I read this book by Kim Carlsberg. It's called Beyond My Wildest Dreams, and it's about her UFO abduction experience. Okay. Now, I'm not going to get into that, of course. But the point that she made was at the beginning of a book when she was explaining what happened with her experience, the abduction experience itself, and then her reaction afterward. I think it's fitting, it's an analogy, a metaphor about how Americans have to understand what's going on in our politics. Because it's we're talking about life and death, we're talking about the life and death of the planet, for that matter, and controlling our own lives. So this is what she said. This is relating to what happened after this is after she explains what actually happened. Then she talks about her reaction, which is what's relevant here. She says, "I pulled myself out of bed and walked over to the window. An unbelievable loneliness crept into my blood, like I had just witnessed the death of my world and all that I loved. I walked away from the window and took a very hot, very long shower. I stood numb, listening to the spray beat against my muddled brain. The water felt like tears from heaven weeping with me as I watched my happy life slip down the drain. My neat little universe had just cracked, and all my years of college hadn't prepared me to confront the ignorance in which I had hidden. My head had not only been ripped out of the sand, it had been taken off, rearranged, and put on backwards. I felt like an animal raised in a cage, released to an outdoors it had never known. The denizens of the wilderness were so alien. One look into their feral eyes had stripped me of all my defenses. The savage insensitivity of those glacial pits breached the shield that had protected me from my own naivete." So she understood, she learned, she realized that her world was not the real world, that there was something bigger out there. And that, in her case, the beings that she ran into had control and had power that she never realized. And she, as she said, her head got out of the sand, and that's what we have to do with our politics.
Yeah. All right, hang on. Thank you, all thank you tonight for developing a well-good and well-dressed presentation. Yeah. Let's give them a hand.
And that's a wrap. College adjourned.
Hey!
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Let's keep it.
Everybody's complex.
Yeah, I'm perplexed.